In Greek mythology, Icarus achieved flight with wings made of feathers and wax. Icarus became so intoxicated by the experience of being airborne that he soared higher and higher. But he, eventually, flew too close to the heat of the sun, and the wax in his wings melted. The Spoony One. Noah Antweiler of the Spoony Experiment. For many, he is symbolic of a golden age of internet video creation where things seem to be unsullied by the anxieties, by the politics of the current year. Back in the day, Spoony had the talent and the charisma to craft quality content that captivated a large audience of devout followers. For a while, it looked as though he was unstoppable. But, like Icarus, he would come crashing down to Earth. This is the story of the rise and the fall of Noah Antweiler.
The Adventures of Bayou Billy.
It was one of those type of games where you either loved it or you hated it.
Oh, Chunky.
It's Reb Brown. I was thinking of leaving YouTube anyway, because I don't get paid here.
Got me fired somehow for making a joke on Twitter.
Look, you guys are the best fans in the world. Oh my god.
Don't tell me how to play.
I was in a really bad car accident.
You injured at all?
I had the wind knocked out of me, but I think I'm okay.
Antweiler joined YouTube on the 6th of July, 2006, a Thursday. Someone born on this date is now 13 years old. Though he would not upload immediately, Antweiler would become transfixed and captivated by the then cultural zeitgeist of angry video game reviewers that were popular on the platform.
Like, why does it suck so bad? Well, I have one complaint, one fucking complaint about this glove. It doesn't work. Now, what's the most important aspect about any game? Well, being able to fucking play it.
Hello, one and all. R-Rank 21 here, and I want to talk to you a bit about something that's bugging the fuck out of me right now.
It's no secret that video games based off of movies and TV shows tend to really suck.
You know, most of us grew up with one system and one system only, and that is the NES. One of the most beautiful systems ever made. Everybody who's owned one loves it. And that's because they had a ton of awesome games. But also, since there were so many games, the NES also had its fair share of shit-ass, horrible, god-awful games.
There was a simple, authentic ethos to this eccentric, off-kilter community. All involved knew that their purpose was to entertain. Nothing more, nothing less.
This is my PlayStation 2. This is my Xbox One. This is my Xbox 360. And this right here is my PlayStation 3. And this is what I like to call the Nintendo Shit Cube.
These people were crafting a new art form, harnessing the hybridized internet video medium to further the field of media criticism.
This game should be used to torture people on death row. This is the only fucking
Inspired by great men like the angry video game nerd and R-Make 21, Antweiler would upload on the 24th of January 2007. His first video, a review of the Nintendo Entertainment System game, The Adventures of Bayou Billy.
Now, I know there's a lot of guys out there doing video game reviews, like the Angry Video Game Nerd and RMake21. I love those guys to death, and I'm not necessarily trying to steal their thunder. What I am trying to do, however, is to share with you one particular game that forever darkened my childhood and probably contributed a great deal to making me the psychological mess that I am today. It's not the shittiest game in the world, although it is shittier than a Mormon prom. But what it is the most nipple-twisting, nut-aching, hair-pulling, ulcer-causing, butt-itching, frustrating motherfucker of a game you ever saw. And that game is The Adventures of Bayou Billy.
There is a sincere modesty, a welcome humility to this first review. The manner in which Antweiler introduces himself to the world, saying that he does not wish to tread on anyone's toes, nor to steal anyone's thunder. It paints a picture of a humble man who is here just to share his own knowledge and humor on the subject at hand with the rest of us. The architecture of Antweiler's review is furnished with spontaneous vociferations over recordings of the video game he is deconstructing.
Oh, look at it. Swamp ninjas! Swamp shinobi on the right there! Oh my god! I'm beating swamp ninjas to death with a stick. And they just jack me in the head and... I'm gonna dropkick the swamp ninjas. Come on, you guys. What is shinobi on the right doing there? Just standing there, like, rooting the other guy on, and he beats me up.
Punctuating the video are jovial live-action inserts of Antweiler recreating his experience of the game being reviewed.
So, you'll notice right away that Billy is a fucking pussy. He's got two attacks, a punch and a kick. Oh my god, make it stop. The music is so funkadelic.
What is already apparent here is the trademark coarse language, heightened persona, and acerbic analysis that would come to define Antweiler's later work.
Now, I remember Bayou Billy being really big as a kid, and playing this game, I'll be damned if I can remember why. All I do remember is that A, it had a bitchin' soundtrack, and B, there was this huge marketing campaign behind it put up by Nintendo or Konami or whatever company made it, starring some kind of Crocodile Dundee Cajun motherfucker who was always all manic and wrestling alligators.
From this first video, it was evident for all to see that Antweiler had the potential to perhaps even surpass those that had initially inspired him. Antweiler then went on to review another Nintendo Entertainment System video game, Samurai Zombie Nation.
Samurai and zombies, you don't fucking need to say anything else. I'm in! Wait, what in the fuck?
His style featured astute remarks on the various successes and failures found within.
She's a Medusa, and she spits horrible death loogies at you when she's trying to swat you down with her flamethrower torch. And there's no health bar, so you can't see how well or how badly you're doing. You know, whether or not you're dying or whether or not you're killing the Statue of Liberty. And check out the nest of snakes on her head. You think that's a little bit of Japanese jingoism much? Wonder if they're a little upset about that nuclear bomb thing.
This insight, combined with a lovable personality and infectious sense of humor, would only serve to grow Antweiler's audience.
Your best? Losers always whine about their best. Winners go home and fuck the prom queen.
That's right, I'm not giving up! I'm gonna kick this naked zombie's ass!
During these early videos, Antweiler would personally capture footage of the game he would be reviewing by using an emulator. He would cite this method as being easier for his production process, as it meant that he could save at specific points and reload in order to gather corresponding clips to match his bombastic commentary. Antweiler would then go on to review E.T. the Extraterrestrial for the Atari 2600.
Every minute I stay in this room, I get weaker. And every minute E.T. squats in the bush, he gets stronger. Each time I look around, the walls move in a little tighter. Everyone gets everything he wants. I wanted a mission. sins, they gave me one. It was going to be the worst game in the world, and I didn't even know it yet.
Antweiler was in a befuddled mental state due to consuming large amounts of painkillers in light of having had all of his wisdom teeth removed. Throughout this review, his behavior is manic, his body heavily perspiring.
I mean, you'll just walk into pits randomly. You'll walk into people on the other side of a screen. You'll have no chance to avoid them. And the graphics, even for the Atari, are horrible. Look at this. I don't even know what this was. I raise my head, and a flower grows, and I got a smiley face. What does that do? Man, I looked that up. I couldn't find out what it does. It's just a waste of my time. I'm halfway down on life. And you see those little black specks on the ground? You know what those are? You'll never figure it out. You know what those are? Reese's Pieces. You know what the Reese's Pieces do? Nothing.
Undervalued in the canon of Antweiler's work, this Apocalypse Now parody that was produced under the influence of mind-altering drugs is transcendent, becoming a legitimate work of art in its own right. Antweiler almost died during the production of this review of E.T., but it was such a commitment to the art form, such a dedication to his craft, that made the Spoony One an international treasure, a household name. He took the medium of video game reviewing on YouTube to a level that hadn't been seen prior. On the 4th of April 2007, Antweiler uploaded the first installment of his multi-part review of the PlayStation 1 game, Final Fantasy VIII.
Hey, wait a minute. Now, hold on a second. Now, who is that? Is that my teacher? Dear God, that's the hottest teacher I've ever seen!
This review was an early magnum opus for Antweiler. His systematic, point-by-point deconstruction of the video game was almost revolutionary, considering that, at the time, Final Fantasy VIII was considered something of a sacred cow.
And if you want magic, you have to draw it from your enemies, which is a combat action. And to do that, you do nothing but draw, basically meaning, if you want magic, you have to do this for every spell, for every enemy you meet, and to do that, you have to do nothing but let the enemy mercilessly wail on you while you draw hundreds upon hundreds of magic spells, just so you can be competitive in combat and cast the magic you want to cast!
Antweiler raised valid criticisms regarding the game's unusual magic system, the muted way in which the characters and script were written, and the different graphical style used following the prior installment.
Headmaster Sid pulls you aside and gives you what he calls a cursed item, but it actually turns out to be a magical lamp. I mean, hey, cool. You have to be careful, but I mean, it's just a magic lamp. What could possibly go wrong? What in the heck is that? El Diablo, no! Oh no. Please have mercy, O Lord of Darkness. No.
What the hell just happened? The devil? Are you kidding me? He gave me a lamp that had the devil in it. I was expecting a happy genie who sings little songs and grants wishes, not the devil!
During this review, a popular mascot for Antweiler's internet brand would be born. Dr. Insano. Insano would serve as a commentary on Final Fantasy VIII's over-the-top antagonist. The review also included a song performed by Antweiler.
For those of you who can't speak Latin, the chorus is saying, real gay, sissy gay, 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 sissy gay, gay, butt sex, astro glide, glory hole balls, teabag!
Many years later, Antweiler would publicly issue an apology for this song. What was clearly an immature and fairly innocuous joke had been rendered offensive and abhorrent with the benefit of hindsight.
Hey, you guys having a good time with all the lesbian jokes and the gay people and the emo things and the gunblade? You know, I'm having a good time making these jokes too. Only I'm not. You see, I may have given you guys the wrong impression when it comes to Final Fantasy VIII. You know, Maybe you thought I was just picking on the characters of the story, and maybe it's really not that bad. Noah's just having a good time tearing down a little fanboy legacy. You know what? That's not what it's about. Final Fantasy VIII, to me, is about one thing and one thing only. Pain!
In these early videos, when Antweiler's content largely consisted of uninhibited monologues about what I rated him concerning video game media, he still managed to deliver a degree of authenticity and charisma that shone through, despite the heightened Spoony persona.
I am thy dungeon master, and today we return to the game of Advanced Dungeons and Dragons. We will now enter into a land of sword and sorcery, of maidens and monsters, of orcs and buggery. Yes, today we enter the realm of Kryn.
More specifically, Advanced Dungeons and Dragons, Heroes of the Lance. Dragonlance, great story. Shit. Game.
The interesting thing about Antweiler was that, during a time when most reviewers restricted their body of work to a certain niche, he would talk about anything and everything that he so desired, with the first point of contact having taken place when he was a child. So besides video games, Antweiler would offer reviews of underrated cinema and obscure British television programs like Nightmare.
Tonight we rediscover Nightmare, a television show that once broadcast many moons ago on the BBC, beamed through a temporal anomaly from a land far away and long ago. Through the eldritch mists of time and magic, brave champions would come from the future, and those with wits and courage enough to delve into the dungeons of deceit and emerge victorious, glory awaited. For the others, only a gooey, sticky end and a long walk of shame back to their own time. The timeout is ended. Adventure begins again.
Rebury would become an ongoing February tradition where Antweiler would put under the microscope the film work of B-movie stalwart Reb Brown.
The greatest forgotten masterpiece of fantasy movies of all time, and it's called Your Hunter of the Future, a movie you can only get on VHS. It rips off so many cinematic cliches that it actually passes infinity, curves back around, and then comes back to become something wholly original again. It is, in a word, transcendent.
Let's begin with our hero, Yor. You know he's badass because he struts around the wasteland to a pumpin' Flash Gordon rock anthem with lyrics that tell us that Yor, well, he's the man. In those exact words. Anyway, he may run like a girl, but trust me, Yor is a fucking death machine, and you'll see why in a second. Suffice to say, you don't mess with him, because he'll scissor kick a bitch if he has to.
Over the course of 2007, a group of corporations that included Viacom sued YouTube because it was hosting prolific amounts of copyrighted content. And by 2008, the platform would start suspending accounts that breached copyright law. The long Indian summer for the angry reviewer community was coming to an end. Those that had uploaded footage of movies, video games, and music without permission were to be the first in the line of fire.
Tonight I'm talking about something that has become a little bit of a problem in the last couple of weeks. Even though it's been a problem that has, you know, been plaguing YouTube for a few years now, it seems to have reared its ugly head in a horrible way in just, like I said, the last few weeks. Talking about false copyright claims. See, guys, YouTube has this really bizarre system for copyright claims. You know, because where other organizations would actually investigate these things prior to enforcing a DMCA claim, YouTube doesn't, which leads to videos and channels getting shut down due to copyright claims that have no bearing.
YouTube's great purge of content was extremely noticeable, affecting some of the most popular creators on the platform. The Angry Video Game Nerd was suspended. Armic21 was closed down.
And that is bullshit! Real, true, unadulterated bullshit!
The writing was on the wall for Antweiler. Three of his videos were struck by copyright claims, and his channel was teetering on the edge of oblivion.
I'm putting this video up because I may not be around on YouTube much longer. I think even I can see the handwriting on the wall. It seems like YouTube has gone to war on its video game reviewers, and I am the last of the Mohicans, so to speak. There are not many of us left.
Meanwhile, another reviewer, known as the Nostalgia Critic, had become an overnight sensation after his polemics on films like Space Jam.
Hello, I'm the Nostalgia Critic. I remember it, so you don't have to. You know, I love the Looney Tunes. Who doesn't? They're funny, they're clever, they're unique, they're absolutely wonderful. And you want to know what else? I love basketball. Again, who doesn't? It's fun, it's intense, it gives you a rush of energy. It's also absolutely wonderful. However, you want to be sure to keep these two elements as far away from each other as humanly possible. Because if you don't, you get fucking Space Jam!
In the aftermath of the great YouTube purge, the Nostalgia Critic would lead an exodus from the platform and onto his website, thatguywiththeglasses.com. One of those invited to join the site as an associate was Antweiler.
Long-term interaction with Klingon society. To succeed in those situations, you will need to know more than how to order a meal. You will need to think like a Klingon.
Okay.
And, as that guy with the glasses was acquiring prevalence on the internet, Antweiler would participate in many crossover episodes with the various bizarre personalities on the site.
Fried ice cream.
match my tone.
No.
What is your problem? Look, I double bagged it, okay? Anyway, that's all the time we've got for Spoony with Spoony. Next week, I'm sure we'll have some more terrific guests. Until then, stay sexy.
Antweiler would also appear in numerous That Guy with the Glasses anniversary specials. It was during the production of Kickassia that a famous story about his behavior would emerge. Though largely missing in action for most of the shoot, Antweiler would become embroiled in a fracas with the top dog. There was a simulated fight scene between the Nostalgia Critic and Antweiler's Dr. Insano character, but Antweiler played too rough and ripped the Nostalgia Critic's M. Bison cape. The next day of the shoot, both refused to look at each other or exchange pleasantries.
Phantasmagoria 2, A Puzzle of the Flesh. I'm just doing this on the spur of the moment, mainly because I just bought this at a used bookstore, and I have never played this game before. I played the original, and I liked it a lot. It was a lot more impressive back in the day. Of course, it has not aged well at all.
Back in 2008, Antweiler was must-watch entertainment. This Phantasmagoria 2 playthrough defines the period where he wasn't just good, but at his zenith.
I overslept. Did I miss the view? It's a good thing we're fading through his morning routine. I don't think we needed to see that. Oh, I actually have control now.
Do you ever sneak into your boss's office and start just pawing through his photos?
You've got to stop it or I will.
I'll kill you, you son of a bitch.
Ah, yes, the Christmas party. We all have fond memories of that one.
Antweiler's playthrough is filled with humor that appropriates that of Mystery Science Theater 3000, with punchy, cultural references meant to poke fun at the game. And this playthrough is the best realization of the MST3K style that many reviewers tried to emulate during this time period.
A booga booga booga.
You scared me, Chris.
Oh, you weren't too scared of me last night.
Ew.
Last night was so...
average. Wow. Oh, get a cubicle. Wow. Hey, Curtis. Playa. Yo, Jacob, finish it! HP issued a recall of its touchscreen monitors today. Don't let this happen to you. Buy McAfee Antivirus Protection.
You miserable,
insane wretch.
Obi-Wan never told you what happened to your father.
But you know your mother was.
Not always.
My mother was a saint! Antweiler was displaying a genuine talent here at making something come alive, even those that would consider themselves uninterested in Let's Plays could see that this odyssey through Phantasmagoria 2 was one of the funniest things that Antweiler ever uploaded. Throughout 2009, as his name recognition amongst general audiences was beginning to reach stratospheric levels, Antweiler's disposition towards certain viewers was becoming fraught and adversarial. It became apparent that Antweiler was thin-skinned and found it difficult to take on board criticism that didn't serve to flatter and praise him absolutely. The forums on his website, thespoonyexperiment.com, would gain infamy for the way in which dissenters were roundly silenced with the impact of a banhammer. On the 16th of December 2009, the digital media website Mashable published its list of Open Web Award winners. Amongst those awarded was Antweiler. This was arguably the highest achievement of his internet career at that point, but instead of celebrating with his audience, he issued a statement entitled An Appeal for Manners. This lengthy screed expressed Antweiler's disgust with the behaviour of his fanbase. And then, in an endeavour that further served to alienate certain sections of his audience, Antweiler varied the canon with an ongoing series called Wrestle Wrestle, which consisted of him expressing genuine passion for professional wrestling in unprocessed and unedited lengthy videos.
I'm going to be talking about wrestling, which I just saw the 3-hour slammy show of Raw. And I'm going to stop you before you even start. And I know a lot of you are going to get on my case for watching wrestling. And, you know, you're right. You're absolutely right.
The reputation of Wrestle Wrestle paled in comparison to that of his normal reviews, with audience members lamenting that this extraneous undertaking was diverting his attention from content that people actually wanted to watch.
No, I said I wouldn't do Wrestle Wrestle this week, but you know how it is with me. I say I'm not going to do something, and I work way too hard sometimes, so I'm editing Final Fantasy. I got Impact on in the background, and sure enough, it sucks really bad, and it sucks so hard that it continues to astound me.
That is not to say that Wrestle Wrestle didn't have a small niche of dedicated viewers, but there were a lot of Antweiler's hardcore fans who openly asked him to stop wasting time on it. But the thing with Antweiler was that he always put himself first as a creator, and his viewers second. His thoughts, his feelings, his ideas were his own. And that was part of the magic, because in an era dominated by adopted personas, Antweiler came across as a peer.
The story of the Ultima series is as old as computer gaming itself, and it stretches all the way to present day with one of the longest-running and most enduring MMORPGs around. And I'm going to take you on the same ride I did from beginning to end. Long years ago, back in caveman time, super nerd Richard Garriott, best known to his friends as Lord British, kept up a hobby of coding his own games, modeled after his tabletop Dungeons & Dragons hobby. The first game was Akalabeth, World of Doom.
Damn, that artwork is badass!
Beginning in 2010, Antweiler's multi-part Ultima retrospective would become widely regarded as his magnum opus.
Once you start sailing around, you'll find a place pretty quick where there's an island with a signpost. Search that area and you'll find a weapon one level better than the one you already have. Go to another nearby signpost to increase your wisdom, and you reset the other signpost so you can search it again and get another weapon. Keep doing this, and you'll get progressively better stuff. From there, you commandeer a starfighter, go into hyperspace, and Jesus fish, it's TIE Fighters! TIE Fighters? What the fuck is going on? Sadly, there's no option to take the gem and assume Mondane's dark throne, but hey, you've got a time machine and all the hot princess poontang you could ever want.
This informative and droll examination showcased his genuine love for the series. As such, it stands at the apex of the internet video game reviewing art form.
So basically, you spend the entire game grinding out gold pieces.
You grind out gold, buy a weapon, find out you can't use it, grind out more gold to give to the Hotel California, but remember, you need to buy food, so you need to grind gold to buy more food, so you can grind more gold, so you can level up, so you can use weapons, so you can grind for more weapons that you can't use. You can check out anytime you like, but you can never leave! Anyway, you do all that, go to the Time of Legends, and surprise, you find out that many of the demons around Minax's fortress are not only badass, but some are invincible. It even says so in the book. Trust me, you can stab him with your steely knife, but you just can't kill the beast.
Nearly all the game footage from Arkalabeth through to Ultima 5 used in the retrospective was borrowed, mostly from an uploader named Alzair. But Ultima 6 and beyond are mostly Antweiler's own recordings.
Right away, when you boot this game up, it feels like something really special is going on. The music is memorable, mysterious, and haunting, and it raises a real sensation of alien terror and fear of something truly dire about to happen. You're once again summoned by the moon gates, but right away you notice something's wrong, because these moon gates are red, but you go in anyway and find yourself standing in some unholy shrine surrounded by a horde of demons who just summoned you here for a blood ritual. They strap you to a stone slab and start chanting from a book as the biggest, scariest one raises a knife to cut your damn heart out. But just in time, your old companions interrupt the ritual and shoot the high priest in the back of the head with a crossbow, and you make your escape back to Britannia.
There is a touching emotional breakdown at the end of his Ultima 9 review. Antweiler claimed that the game tainted pleasant memories of him and his brother playing the originals when they were children.
Probably my earliest, one of my earliest memories is around the age of, must have been 3 or 4. We just moved to Arizona, and my dad was an engineer, and we had this new thing. It was this monochrome computer, 5 1/4 inch floppies, and it was the craziest thing because it could do word processing and it could do spreadsheets. And my dad would work from home, which again was this new thing. You know, you didn't have to use a typewriter. So, when he was at work, my older brother and I would play on it. And we only had one game. It's probably the first game, probably the first computer game I ever played. And that was, it was Ultima 3.
The segment is heartbreaking to bear witness to, because Antweiler steps out of character to articulate what exactly Ultima meant to him and why he is so distraught by the 9th installment.
My older brother and I, we must have played everything up to Ultima 6 while we were living under the same roof. And then he moved away to college. He moved away. But that was our thing when we were together, you know. What I really appreciate about that was he didn't have to do that, you know. He was like 10 years older than me. And he'd play that game with me because he was cool like that. And whenever I think of him, that's what I think of. And I miss that. Yeah. I miss fighting the floor in Ultima 3.
In September 2010, Antweiler would declare a competition centered around his acclaimed Ultima retrospective. In Ultima 3, the grass was an enemy which would suddenly strike the player. So Antweiler's competition was for his audience to submit short films based upon the notion of fighting grass.
When we first learned of the grass's nature, we attempted to establish contact. It didn't work so well. Now with a significant problem on our hands, we had to find out how to get rid of it. We attempted the usual methods. They didn't work so well. And finally we brought in the army. That didn't work so well either.
It was a wholesome, innocent time, and the creativity of Antweiler's audience was in glorious abundance.
What's up, guys? I'm Rorschach. Today, I'm going to beat up the lawn. Oh yeah, it's time to kick some grass.
What Antweiler offered as a reward for the winner of this competition was a signed photograph of himself, which would be considered emblematic of his increasing narcissistic tendencies. but the competition was demonstrably successful, with 146 submissions from an audience desperate to curry Antweiler's favor.
Hello? It's time.
Time for what?
The grass? The thing we've been training for, like, all last week? The evil thing we're gonna fight? The grass?
Grass. It's been torturing me all these years.
Being one of the few people to recognize how poor Phantom Menace was initially, I sure as hell was fooled.
It was, again, I don't consider myself, like, brilliant for recognizing that it was bad. It was just like, maybe it's the fact that, I think a lot of people just wanted to believe so badly. You know, they couldn't believe, could it have entered your mind that a Star Wars movie could be bad?
As Antweiler's internet presence was attracting huge audiences and his reputation as a man at the top of his field became more and more recognized, he was also cementing himself as a celebrity within the video gaming industry itself. He would become a regular at conventions where he would often be invited to speak at panels. Where people would flock to Antweiler on the internet, they were now venturing into the real world to bask in the warm glow of the Spoony One.
Here with Noah Antweiler from the Spoony Experiment.
Hi, this is Braden, the Cinema Simpleton, here at Com Bravo 2011 with Doug Walker, the Nostalgia Critic, and Noah Antweiler, the Spoony One. Just do a quick picture, guys.
No problem.
Awesome. Really really close now.
Christ, you fool!
Countermonkey would be another popular series amongst Antweiler's audience. Here, he would regale viewers with tales of his experiences in the world of tabletop role-playing games.
There's a few rules that I think every Dungeons & Dragons dungeon master develops over the course of a lifetime. That sometimes, you know, when you're talking to other players, they'll tell you, but usually not. I think every DM kind of independently comes across a few of these rules. And one of them is never put a deck of many things in your campaign. Ever.
The Countermonkey series was largely unscripted and unedited, but what it did was demonstrate Antweiler's natural ability as an engaging storyteller, and would be responsible for igniting the interest of many in his audience for tabletop RPGs.
Vampire the Masquerade in brief. What happens is there's Cain and Abel, and Cain murders his brother Abel, God curses him, and he becomes the first vampire. So, everything is leading up to Judgment Day, essentially. And in this case, Judgment Day is called Gehenna, when Cain finally wakes up or crawls out of whatever hole he climbed into, and essentially destroys the world. You know, him and his antediluvians, the original vampires he create, will wake up from their slumber, go mad, and devour everything. And so, everything in terms of the plot of Vampire is kind of centered around this concept of Gehenna coming. The end of the world is coming. These immortal creatures who fear nothing but time are running out of time.
Be it scripted or unscripted, Antweiler's work was born from a place of authenticity. Whether one concurred with his points or not regarding a certain item of media, it was impossible to say that he didn't always appear to be genuinely believing in everything that he was saying. Even in something he would find absolutely abominable, Antweiler had the ability to find an aspect to praise, like how he expresses genuine love for the concert sequence in Final Fantasy X-2, despite finding the rest of the game irredeemable.
Well, shit. That was actually really good.
No, really, I'm not kidding. When I played this game the first time, I was legitimately dreading this scene, especially after the god-awful Real Emotion opening. But this scene is honestly pretty damn brilliant.
Antweiler's decline would start in earnest when, on the 11th of May 2012, he made an offensive joke about sexually violating a fellow That Guy with the Glasses associate, a woman by the name of Jesu Otaku.
Hi, Yuzu Otaku here. Sorry if I don't look remarkably put together, if the lighting's bad or whatever. Actually, I never look remarkably put together. What am I talking about? Basically, I am very swamped with lots of things that I have to do and don't have time to put out a full-fledged review for about another 2 weeks.
While Antweiler's joke flew under the radar, a month later, it was brought out into the open by another female contributor to That Guy with the Glasses, Obscurus Looper.
I don't normally do videos like this on my channel, but because it's something that's been getting a lot of attention lately, I thought that I should do a video to address some of these things.
A heated interaction between her and Antweiler played out publicly over Twitter. The consequence of this was that Antweiler was issued a month-long suspension from That Guy with the Glasses, while there were some quarters that laid charges on Obscurus Looper for exhuming a joke that went largely unnoticed. She bolstered her view on the matter with a long blog post entitled "The Uncomfortable Subject of Rape Jokes." Around the same time, another contributor to That Guy with the Glasses would also voice their opposition to Antweiler's behavior.
Highlight, for gamers in North America at least, conjures up images of the top 10 worst games ever created, and yet in Japan, it's a cult classic. Why is that?
On the 21st of June, 2012, Lord Cat spoke at great length about his troubled experiences working alongside Antweiler.
I no longer respect Noah Antweiler. I used to respect him because I felt he put a lot of work into his videos. The man is possibly the single largest waste of talent I've seen in a very long time. And I am sitting here today telling you, Noah Antweiler, you need to give up. You are the second most loathsome person I've ever had the displeasure of knowing.
Lord Cat would also detail supposed instances of Antweiler ruining potential advancements in his career.
But I think it's time the whole world, Spoony, heard just how much of a fucking idiot you truly are. You and that other idiot, Joe. When you were at E3 that one year, and you decided to go up and down the hallways screaming about XCOM's betrayal, and Joe decided to ask people, can I choke you on camera?
Yeah. And the guy was there playing it real time.
Yeah.
And
so I saw the footage, and there was one word searing through my mind like bolts of fire. And that word, betrayal!
What?
Betrayal! Betrayed me! This game sucks! It is nothing to do with XCOM. Nothing! Nothing!
I think this is the birth of Angry Spoony.
Nothing to do with XCOM! Like, the first thing they did, they were like, okay, here's XCOM, it's got aliens, and it's like, it's so...
Guess what happened, Spoony? Guess what fucking happened? The whole gaming industry turned its back on me. Not you, not Joe, not Blistered Thumbs, me.
The That Guy with the Glasses website then posted a farewell to the Spoony One, a statement that served to sever their professional ties to and working relationship with Antweiler. Though this was a setback, as he was essentially excluded from a community of creators that gave lots of support to one another, Antweiler would suggest that this expulsion wasn't as detrimental to him as it at first seemed.
I suppose that I should address the pink elephant in the room by talking about my departure from Channel Awesome. People kind of settled on the theory that Lupa got me fired somehow for making a joke on Twitter. That was not what got me quote-unquote fired, and it didn't really stem, you know, my departure. It wasn't like that. It didn't help, but that wasn't why. In many ways, I just didn't need Channel Awesome anymore. I just didn't. In the sense that it was a really one-sided relationship, but also on another respect, their website is so poorly designed. It really is atrocious. Basically, they talked to me and they said, you know, you can't be this way online. And I go, why? And I go, why? You know, I can say what I want. And so that was my being a bitch. But they were like, you know, you represent the company now. And we can't have somebody representing the company if they're going to act like this. And I go, fair enough. You know, I said, fair enough. I want to be me. I want to say what I want to say. even if that shit is offensive. And so, you know, even the situation with Lupa, it was the kind of thing where I wasn't really sorry for what I said. I was sorry the situation turned so ugly, but, you know, it wasn't even the kind of joke that everyone thought it was the kind of joke. But even so...
On the 24th of October 2014, Antweiler uploaded a video where he commemorated the fulfillment of a Patreon goal.
Somehow, you guys have reached the Patreon goal where it was listed that I would start work on a movie... And I was just, I was blown away by this. It was like, you guys are the best fans in the world. Oh my God. Ah, it was just astonishing. Oh my God. And thank you so much. Wow.
Fans had decided to gift him $5,000 a month in order to crowdfund the production of a Spoony movie.
I guess we'll start with the movie in question and what this means and does not mean. So, the movie. Yes, you guys reached the amazing, I thought unreachable goal of a movie. Not that I put it intentionally out of reach. I didn't. But I still can't believe it. That's amazing.
Instead of sounding elated, Antweiler carried about him the look of a man racked with guilt. He seems more concerned than happy at having reached his $5,000 a month goal.
I am making it a priority to start scripting that out and get moving on it. When will you see results? That's the tricky thing. I don't know. As in, once I kind of get an idea of what kind of movie I want to do, I have to get an idea of what my limits on budget are. That's not begging for money. What that means is you have to write within your means. You know what I mean? So, like, I can't write a super sci-fi space epic. You know, I can't write a movie worth, you know, billions of dollars. I can't write something really, really extravagant with a lot of, you know, hyper martial arts and stuff like that. With stuntmen and all this stuff. The stuff I can't procure. So I have to write something within my means, within the contacts of people I know. You know, that's what I mean.
Although his audience had pledged $5,000 a month for him to crack on with the production of a Spoony movie, Antweiler decided to use the money to embark on other, arbitrary projects that nobody asked for. Ongoing series like Livewire would signify his downfall. Livewire would be notorious for the sheer lack of effort displayed. These lengthy Let's Plays would be almost completely without commentary. Antweiler's audience were disgusted by this behavior. Failing to honor his commitments, he would be accused of taking the money and proceeding to run. But it soon became apparent that the light behind Antweiler's eyes was beginning to fade.
Every time I get a donation, I kind of have really mixed feelings about it because... And I know sometimes you're actually insulted that I have mixed feelings about it. Like, I shouldn't. I should be grateful and I should be happy and I should feel deserving of such donations. But really, every time I get a donation, I feel a little guilty, to be honest. I always have had a problem accepting charity.
Turn this job from a hobby filmed on a webcam into a dream job that I can make a living off of. And the only reason I've made it this far is because of you.
Don't tell me how to play.
The generosity is unbelievable. I'm not worthy of it.
You know, now is not a good time to smartass me.
So I just wanted to let you know that I still remember where I come from, and entertaining you guys and making you laugh is the reason that I love what I do.
Sending her your prayers. Fuck you. Fuck you for even suggesting something like that.
Hey, what was that? I saw someone.
Fuck you.
up on things. I can't let these movies and games keep beating me like they've been beating me lately, like Red Brown and Final Fantasy. I mean, what good am I to you? Why would you watch if I just walk out on things like I have been lately? It doesn't make any sense. I need to nut up. I need to start winning again.
Though no longer the prolific creator he once was, he did develop another addiction, but unlike his obsession with reviewing articles of pop culture in an interesting fashion, this addiction would only serve to drive away the large crowds that had shown him adulation. Antweiler would take to Twitter to vent, with the account averaging at least 1,000 tweets a month. Tweets that were marred with the tired embitteredness that had increasingly consumed Antweiler. This Twitter addiction would enter catastrophic levels when he made an account, LARPing as his pet dog. He would also barrage his Twitter followers with an extensive litany of illnesses that he had come to convince himself that he was being afflicted by. And, on the 7th of December 2017, Antweiler bizarrely posted a tweet that got his original Spoony account suspended for promoting murder.
A lot of news, I guess. None of it good. My Twitter account got suspended. Permanently, man. I have no clue why. They won't tell me. That's about it. I appealed and they said no. So, there you go. They said it was something to do with, like, promoting harassment, or, they weren't even specific about that. It was either promoting harassment or, violence, something like that. They never got any more specific than that. And, that you get one appeal and that's it. I don't even think anybody really looked at it. There's, you know, there's fucking Nazis out there, and no, I'm the problem, you know.
Hey, you know me, and you may know my brother Miles. He was very insistent that he be a part of this review of James Cameron's Avatar, which we just got back from seeing. And I guess we'll turn to you right away, because we're kind of in a little bit of a hurry, because he has to go to work very soon. So let's get your brief review out of the way.
Well, I think if we're going to look at this plot-wise, it's very close to Dances with Wolves. I mean, if we're going to be simultaneously looking at the plots, it's about a soldier that gets his leg injured in a war.
On the 27th of May, 2019, Antweiler explained that he had recently been involved in a car accident that had broken his ribs.
Most relevant, I was in a really bad car accident. I felt fine at first, but I started really hurting later on, which I'm told is actually kind of normal. Like, apparently, like, adrenaline is a hell of a drug. Started feeling really bad, though, a few days later. I went to the hospital. I had broken ribs. Did I finally jump my ponytail? No. I had like two or three broken ribs. Severe, what do they call it? Severe bruising of the chest wall. That was about it. They thought for some reason I had pneumonia because I had a really bad cough, but that wasn't true.
What Antweiler failed to mention, however, was that he was the one directly responsible for this. A report from the Aurora Police Department judged that he had violated traffic law by running a red light and hitting another car. There is even dash cam footage of the incident.
Are you okay?
I'm in a lot of pain.
Okay, what happened?
The other car ran the red light as we were going through.
How you doing? Are you injured at all?
I had the wind knocked out of me, but I think I'm okay.
Okay. You had airbag deployment?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you have your driver's license and insurance?
Yes.
I witnessed it. I pulled the car over there on that side, but okay. I was behind him. Okay. So I don't know if you need me to stick
yes,
around.
Yes, I do. Okay. Come here. What happened?
Okay, so the car back there totally ran the light.
Okay.
It was solid green. He went forward, and that one just came nodding back.
Okay, which way was that car headed?
That one was going this way, and he was coming this way. This one right here was going this way.
That way?
Yeah, and that one was there.
And went through the light?
Yep.
Okay. Tell me what happened.
Okay. I was in the right lane, and I was driving along speed limit. I had the green light. He turned right in front of me. I tried to swerve to the left. He kept coming. I hit him in the front, the front passenger side. And that's it.
I got two witnesses that said you ran red light. Besides, not even these guys.
I don't have to tell you, it's not true. I had the green light.
Okay. One of them has a dash cam, so.
Okay.
Unfortunately, I'm going to have to write you a ticket for disobeying the traffic light.
Did you see the dash cam?
Huh?
Did you see the dash
I'm
cam?
I'm still going to have to write it.
Okay.
So, all right, let these guys take care of you, okay?
There was a bunch of stuff. I had to go to court. I was cited for the accident, but long story. Apparently, for some tickets, you have to go to court. It was a unique experience. I learned a lot.
Antweiler took no accountability for a car crash that could have killed somebody.
He's looking to make an impression.
I don't fucking care.
Looking forward to signing, and hopefully he's going to be better.
Well, a new day.
Antweiler made some great content over the years, but there was always a self-destructive streak in him that encouraged his innate sedentary behavior. Even during his heyday, he could never release his reviews on time, and he became increasingly reliant on unedited vlogs, doubling down on wrestling reviews that his audience absolutely hated. But his Patreon grew and grew. Eventually, it got to $5,000 a month. He was able to buy his own house. He was set. He had a loyal girlfriend and had finally moved out of his family home. Things were looking up. For Antweiler, the future was bright, but then he just stopped making content. He promised everyone a movie that never happened. He couldn't bother to do any of the things that people were paying him to do. And so his Patreon started to heavily decline. He managed to lose his girlfriend of 4 years, a woman who was working a part-time job at Subway and running an Etsy store in order to pay Antweiler's mortgage. He refused to undertake a job away from the internet. Now that his girlfriend's income has gone, his house is being foreclosed. And instead of addressing the pertinent problems that he's facing, all Antweiler does is unhealthily distract himself from the reality of the situation. He ended the last decade by turning 39 and unknowingly cosplaying as Wormtongue from The Lord of the Rings. Instead of raging against the dying of the light, Antweiler decided to capitulate entirely.
Oh, I could probably pay my bills with regular videos? Well, Harizo, if your mom would get back to whoring down by the pier, you could probably make rent, but I'm not putting any pressure on her either.